Am I on now? Yeah.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the innovation program of IEEE ISIP 2016 at Phoenix. My name is Haohong Wang. I'm here with my colleagues Jeff and Claire to chair the whole afternoon session with you. It is a great moment to be with you and many of our friends who are actually sitting in front of their mobile phone or TV or a PC monitor to view this in the YouTube live streaming video. So we're not only people here, we also have many, many crowded people outside of us, but they witness with us. Today, for this historic moment, the generation of the world first visual innovation award. This is a moment that we have been waiting for a long time. But today we put all the world leading innovations together with seven finalists and bring all the executives of the seven innovations to tell us their vision and the stories behind these innovations. So today we also have 12 keynote speakers with us. They are actually sitting with us now. They will share with us their vision about the future of the visual innovations. So let's talk about the award first. So here you will see seven innovations and the people behind these innovations. We have Achin of Intel, who is the inventor of Intel RealSense. We have Steve Chen, is the co-founder of YouTube. We have Bill Daly, is the chief scientist of NVIDIA, who is behind the whole efforts of the CUDA platform. We have Reed, the co-founder of Netflix. We have Brandon, of co-founder of Oculus. We have Alex, the inventor of Kinect. We have Ren, behind Lytro as the founder and the inventor. So look at these seven innovations. Some of them focus on technology innovation. Some of them are focusing on business model innovations. Some of them change the people's life with the products. Okay, so today actually, all of you being here will vote to decide who will be the final champion of the award. So ask for yourself from heart, okay, which of them that impact your life, your family's life, your friend's life, and the life of people today or in the future? Which one? Select the ones and vote before 4 p.m. today. So you, this moment is built by us together. If we recall, since this is the world's first award in this kind, so we take it in a very serious process. We call for nominations 10 months before now. So last November, we sent out the call for nominations. Some of you have seen the posters like that. And in the poster, I actually see the first step for us is to select a world executive group behind to select the finalists from the nominees. If you look at these executives, they're representing different aspects, areas of the visual innovations. Some people are coming from content creation area. For example, like Hanoff from 20th Century Fox. Some people come from software areas, like Microsoft. Some people come from the technology side, like Adobe Labs. People from the service side, like YouTube or Netflix. People from solutions, like Cisco. People from hardware, like Qualcomm, MediaTek. People even from the capital areas, like James from the Camo Capital. People from government, like Martin from Swiss National Science of Foundation. So actually some of people from the Asia, some people from Europe, some people from the Americas. So we try to make sure the committee is diversified, you know, cover all the aspects from the visual innovation so that they could give us a very fair solution or selection of the finalists. Out from 36 nominees, they select 7 finalists, which you have seen here. And we bring the executives of these innovations come to stage today to tell you their stories and their futures, to let you decide whether you vote for them or not. Okay. So you are the very important contributors to this whole campaign, to select at this historic moment, select the world first visual innovation award. So one thing to remember, the vote will close by 4 p.m. So you can use your mobile phone, use your laptop, do the voting anytime. You know, once you see, oh, this innovation touched my heart so much. I cannot wait. I just vote now. I cannot wait for other people to finish their keynotes. Okay? So the winner will be awarded tonight at the banquet and award ceremony. So let's look at the agenda of the innovation program. It's a whole half day program that starting from now, we have the next 2 hours, maybe another 20 min7 that 7 executives will go over their innovations and their visions behind the innovations to all of you. Then after that, we invited a very special speaker who is a pioneer and a veteran in the area in promoting the collaborations between academia and industry. He spent in his past 30 years to do this. So Professor C.C. Jekyll of University of Southern California. So he will be here to share with you the challenges, the opportunities, and also his success during this kind of collaborations for the visual innovation. After that, we have another session, which is we have 4 executives that of the world leading companies, they will be here to show you their vision about the future. Okay, so we have people from 20s, executive from 20th Century Fox, Huawei, Qualcomm, Cisco. They're representing their visions of their company and also their visionary thoughts. So let's start from the first segment of the innovation program by introducing the first speaker, which is Michael, the co-founder of Oculus. Michael will tell you about the breakthroughs of the VR, which is the hottest area. He is a young, very young man here, but did a lot of successful things. If you look at his story here, you know, he had 2 companies co-founded, but successfully, you know, sold them with big bucks, right? The first one, $36 million, not enough. The second one, $2 billion. He sold Oculus to Facebook. Let's hear what he say as a pioneer of the VR to talk about his thoughts and his product. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, okay. Helen. So about 4 years ago, I was lucky enough to try out a first handmade prototype of the Rift. It looked something like this. There was foam core, glue, and lots of wires hanging out. Yet at the same time, it already gave this promise of bringing us to new and different worlds. So we decided to start a company and launch it on Kickstarter. At the time, we didn't truly know what it would take to take it from early sketches to a more complete commercial product. Yet as early as the original handmade prototype was, it already gave a promise of what it would take and what type of potential VR would have for people. Now, of course, it was obvious for us, especially coming from a game industry, that the first thing would be gaming. So let me show you for just a moment some of the amazing experiences they've been able to bring. Isn't it amazing what VR developers have been able to put together in just a little bit over a year? Now, of course, beyond the gaming, the range of applications is much more far-reaching. You can see that VR has potential to take people into new different places, the places where some of them may not be able to go in real life for virtual travel. You can also do training, demonstrating how to do procedures in medical and industrial fields. You could make things, sculpt things, objects in space in VR. You can also build a house visually and see what it's like to be there before it's actually constructed. Maybe you'll decide to make some changes. So the scope is really incredible. And at the same time, I think one of the more exciting parts of it is communication. The idea that you can talk with somebody far away and who are on the other side of the globe, but actually really in front of you. And from the very beginning, all of us at the company knew that this would be the one big potential. At the same time, it's also the one which would have required the most technical challenges. So, to kind of bring this vision of Oculus together, we had to really build a team of people from all the different disciplines. In the very beginning, it was hard for me personally to imagine like all the things we would need to cover. Of course, we had software and electronics. That's just needed to bring the basic product to life. But then there was obviously mechanics and optical engineering. The optics turned out to be really hard because there's a lot of challenges such as field of view and eye box size, how much you can move, and screen door, different aberrations which come into play, so there's no perfect lens. And in the same time, of course, there's computer graphics and computer vision. Computer vision, I will talk more about because it has this huge potential of tracking everything around you in the world to help create both the communication experiences and many other things. And then, of course, there is the backend and social platform. This is the type of thing which Facebook has been good at, yet at the same time, there's a lot of unique Oculus-related and VR-related challenges. So now I'll talk a little bit about the beginning. When we were just starting, we were a small team, and we didn't really have the capabilities of addressing all those things in depth. So I'll touch on a few simple problems, you can say, which we had to deal with. So one of them was actually distortion. So as you put the lens in front of a screen, you actually get concussion distortion, so your image is curved. Now, this is particularly meaningful when you have a rift and big screen in front of your face. Now, most of you know that it can be solved with a number of simple equations. Here's one which you can find in a book, which actually brings pixels radially towards the center. Now, when you look at something like this, it's simple to throw into code, yet in the same time, the tricky part is, which exactly equation do you use for your lens, And the second one is, what are the coefficients which you come here? So to start, we simply worked on doing manual tuning. We took a scene, like this is a Tuscany scene which we shipped in one of the original Rifts, and binded keys for coefficients on the keyboard. So you can actually press up and down, and the world, the scene would curve in front of you. And by doing that, after you straighten down the lines, you could turn them off and actually look around in the world. Sometimes seeing just the flat lines, an actual world is different. So one of our employees got really good and proficient in that, to the point that we called them the golden eye. Now, he had many lenses to tune, lots of headset prototypes, yet very often it would be that Brendan would put on the headset and move it around and see there is like something swimmy in the periphery. Doesn't feel quite right. So we had to retune it, and it kind of started a call to arms in the company. We really want an automated system for doing this. So how do we do it? And the reality is, at the early times, there were almost as many solutions for this as there are engineers. We tried a few things. One was actually just taking coefficients from an optical software and try to map them to what our software has. Didn't work quite as well as you'd hope. Then we tried the camera and lenses. You can put in a camera and observe the image, but there's an own set of challenges. This particular prototype was actually one of my favorites. It was originally done at home by one of our employees, Simon, and he shined lasers through the lens. You can see that the laser can actually move at different angles, and it produces an image in the back. You can sort of try to understand what the profile of a particular lens is and map it to software. Yet 2 years later, it turned out that the hand-tune distortion was still winning. So there's some good job security for GoldenEye. Now, the part of a challenge comes actually from modeling the human eye and all the details and not just the lenses. Ultimately, I do hope that an automated solution is the right way to go. Now, here's another challenge which we faced when we shipped DK1. It was no positional tracking. As you took the headset, and if you were to move left or right in the world would drag with you. So we obviously knew that we needed to address that, and optical tracking was one possible way of doing it. Ideally, what we'd like to do is have a headset be aware of its surroundings, track the world, yet it was a small company, and we had about 6 to 9 months, which we wanted to ship the next version. Also, we really needed it to be robust. Like in VR, 1 millimeter error in perception can actually result in a meter movement far away from you. So the scene can really get jittery. So you need to have something really robust. So what we actually came up with was the LED solution, which is you put LEDs on your headset, and which are infrared, and they can be seen on a camera externally, and we can use them to reconstruct the pose. Now, one of the other challenges which were there were actually, how do you know from these LEDs which ones they are? There's about 40 of them, and depending on your pose that you take from different angles, the solution may actually be ambiguous. We tried different ways of addressing this. One way to arrange things in particular shapes and lines and decode it, but that may not have always been working well with occlusion if some of them are not visible. So the actual solution we came up with in the beginning was modulating the brightness of these LEDs over different frames. It's very simple, really. It's not necessarily an advanced technique, but by tracking them and figuring out over multiple frames, we knew which each one of the LEDs was, and we're able to solve for the pose. It's actually a very fun time working on that. And one of the researchers at UC Davis did a write-up about the Oculus Rift and how the tracking works. So I actually wanted to share a video he put on his site. It's Oliver Kralos at delcoque.org. So this shows how you can acquire and identify the LEDs within the model. Now, longer term, we were able to actually solve this without requiring the decoding, and we have an optical team working on tracking and many other things. Yet this demonstrates what it takes to kind of bring a robust product to market. Sometimes you need to make quick choices, and I think this turned out well. Then, of course, one of the biggest challenges, I would say, and things which happen is, in the beginning, when you put on a Rift, you could see this world, yet it was kind of lonely. Like, it's pretty, but at the same time, I said that AR and VR is one of the most exciting things for communication. So clearly, we needed to bring people into this world. And actually, this is where a lot of hard research begins. So what do we need? Well, at the very basic, to start, we'd like to have hands. We'd like to be able to go and manipulate objects, and a lot of companies address this, but it's still doing it right is a challenging thing. You'd also like to have head, so you can have eyes, facial expressions to communicate to other people. Doing this well is not easy. Then once you have your eyes and head, you'd like to also have the environment. So you'd like to know where you are so you can bring in other people next to you for communicating. And of course, once you have the environment, you'd like to know where the obstacles are so people don't run into each other and so on. So these are all challenging areas. And it kind of starts a rabbit hole into more computer vision research. Here's actually a demo which Yirsa Sheikh showed at the F8. Here he has built models of humans for testing in a panoptic dome, which has lots of cameras and is able to track over 100,000 points and reconstruct the skeletons. We do this to understand how much do you actually need to know about the bodies to communicate and to express emotion. So at the time, he illustrated a number of people playing a mafia game within the dome. Here's an example of them. Now, what he did is first he actually showed just a video of them playing, and then tried to display the skeletal bodies of them. Now, what you could see from the original video is, based on the expressions, that one of the players was actually lying and was, and other players eventually were able to recognize it. However, this was much harder to do in the scene when you also have the skeletons. So clearly, there is a lot of detail which needs to go in to track and address these issues. Yet, at the same time, there is still a lot we can achieve with much simpler approaches. Here's an example of Oculus Touch. You can see that we'll be shipping these controllers later this year, and it lets you simulate the grip and simple gestures with your hands, and also track and manipulate space. It's actually pretty awesome to be inside of it. Believe it or not, just having the head, hands, and voice lets you pass along a remarkable amount of personality in the experience. We had an interesting story about that from CES. At the time, we were demonstrating touch for people, allowing them to interact with each other. Each player would put it in their own Rift room, so they really didn't get to meet in real life, and they were interacting with a stranger. At the time, an employee of Oculus, let's call him Phil, was playing Toy Box demo, which is what you just saw, with a woman who he hasn't met, Anna. They had fun playing the game together and exploring different toys in the scene, and then they went their own separate ways without ever having met each other in real life. Later in the day, however, Phil was ordering a drink at one of the CES after parties, and he saw a woman who was suddenly familiar to him. So he looked up and said, "Anna," and then she recognized him and said, "Phil." They were able to recognize each other and just based on the voice and the body language from that scene. Now, I don't know if there's more to the story, but one thing is certain, that even with simple tracking you could really provide compelling and remarkable experiences. think about where things will take us as this gets better. I'll give you one more example.
That looks like Big Ben to me.
And there's Big Ben, yep.
This is Shrep interacting with VR during FAA
conference. Where is that? Oh, there it is, right back there, the London Eye. That's pretty sweet. That's pretty sweet. Cool. Hey, they're getting a selfie in front of Big Ben.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I never really got a selfie in front of Big Ben before.
I may have a solution for that. Another experiment we've been trying is the virtual selfie cam.
All right. Woo! Hey, you got this sweet avatar, and I'm just like the Blue Man Group over here. What's going on?
Well, so using these another experiment here, these pens, you can draw on your avatar and customize yourself, but we've already prepared one for you.
Ah, perfect. So I just put this on?
Yeah, slip it on like a mask.
Whoop! All right, let's do this. Woohoo! Selfie!
There you go. Oh, wait, no, wait. I think you need one more thing.
Wait,
detail. Hold on 1 second here.
Okay.
Let's do this.
Uh-huh.
Like this.
Uh-huh.
So let me color this in a little bit, like that.
All right.
Okay.
What
and
we
one
got here?
More detail here.
All right.
Oh. What do you think?
That looks great. Can I put that on?
Yeah. Hold still.
All right.
There you go.
Okay. So what do we got? Oh, sweet. Although, you know, if this is a formal occasion, I think we need to hook you up too. So let's.
Cool. All right.
Not a pencil. Not yellow. Let's go with red bow tie. That's what I'm thinking. What do you think, Mr. Booth?
That sounds classy.
Let's
do this.
Class this photo up a little bit. All right. Get rid of that. All right. Hold still, please. Perfect. All right. Now
nice.
We can do
very
this,
classy.
Right?
All right. Let's get
Big Ben selfie in VR.
Selfies.
Woo! Bunny ears. All right.
So the pose we just took, they're right there on the table.
Oh, cool.
Can,
check it out. I nailed the bunny ears. Got that one. That one's pretty good.
Nice bunny ears.
Put that one down.
Yeah.
I don't really like that one as much.
No, not good.
I don't really like that one either. How about this one? Can we get this on Facebook?
Yeah, you know, you can post that directly to your wall. Just drop it in this Facebook post office box.
Right here?
Yep.
Bye-bye, Bits.
There it goes. That is now on your wall.
It's on my wall, publicly available for all to see.
Right now.
Right now. Posted from here. That's amazing. All right, Mr. Booth. I could spend all day in here, but I think I should probably get back to this talk.
So, obviously, there's a lot more coming in this industry. And I think one of the most awesome things about VR is that, and that's what actually makes it special, is when people put on the Rift and the memories they create, I actually have been there. They don't remember a screen, they don't remember just participating, they're actually part of that experience, which is truly amazing. And I think by all of us working in this field and solving the complex image processing, computer vision, tracking, and all the data-related challenges is really exciting because we'll be able to bring people closer to each other and remove a lot of the limitations of the physical world and kind of enable collaboration. And I think these are the goals which are truly worth striving for. So thank you for inviting us here today.
Yeah, so we allow questions. There are microphones stand over there. So if you have questions, you can go there to ask questions. We can have one or two questions for Michael. Any questions, guys? Yeah, please go there.
That particular one was using a motion special down.
Any other questions? No question? Too excited? So from now on, I hope if you want to ask questions, please stand on both sides so we know actually you have questions. So thank you so much, Michael.
All right, thank you. Yeah.
Take it away. You can take it away. Yeah, don't worry. So let's move to our next speaker. So next speaker, actually, Achin, the vice president of Intel. Achin will tell us about his baby, actually, in Intel called RealSense technology. He is an entrepreneur scholar. He is also two books. He has more than 100 patents. He is a fellow of Society of Information Display, and he is a guest professor of many universities, including Stanford, Berkeley, and so on. So let's welcome Achin.
Thanks, Arvind.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. So I have the privilege to present this to you, but the credit belongs to the genius engineers and scientists back at my team at Intel. So there's a revolution that's happening in the world of computer vision and image processing. We're taking a leap from processing pixels to enhance our pictures and videos to the world of visual understanding, visual intelligence. I'm really honored to be here today to talk to you about Intel RealSense technology. That has been our effort at providing you with a development platform to bring this to life. So let's get started. The lofty goal that we took to ourselves collectively between Intel and our development partners was to look deeply into the biology and mimic the human perceptual system as we went about building RealSense technology. So very quick, high-level look at the human perceptual system. You could break it down into roughly four stages in the process. It starts with sensing, perceptual sensors such as eyes that are transducing the photons into electrochemical signals being sent to the visual cortex of your brain, the hearing process, the touch sensing, all of your perceptual sensing. The next stage is understanding, recognizing what you see. I recognize Hao Hong, first recognize he's a human, and then I understand who the person is. Next stage for us is to use that information to do something, either address someone, navigate in the world. And the last stage is what makes us specially human, separate from the machines for a period of time, hopefully, to come, which is the learning process. We use all of the information to continuously learn. So I know I shouldn't step down, I'm going to hurt myself. Or I understand the emotions on your face and I learn to do that. It's the world of machine learning and artificial intelligence. So we wanted to bring all of that together, from the sensing to processing to developing interactions to continuous learning to improve. And don't forget the brain, the hardware, because when you want to do all that, we have recognized that the key enabler for that is hardware, and we need to take a deep look into the brain and borrow the ideas from visual cortex, auditory cortex, the somatosensory cortex, and build the processing platform for the interactive machines. So with that, let's take just 10 seconds look at the human visual system, and then I'm going to show you another sensing system. We take it for granted, but we got a very sophisticated 3D visual sensing system comprising two eyes and the visual cortex of the brain. So as we are constantly taking these two pictures that are shifted from each other, we are computing the binocular disparity between similar points in space, and then my brain's calculating the 3D structure in real time. It's amazing, this is basic. We need that for real-time visual understanding. But that's not just it. One that we don't even often recognize is the vestibular sensing system. Those are those three mutually perpendicular rings on two sides of your head, close to the inner ear, that have circled in red circles. Those are filled with fluid. Consider them as body's motion tracking system. So you're constantly combining the motion sensors from your inner ear, the data from there, and the changes in your visual field to do a really good positional motion tracking as you're recognizing the world. So with that, we really wanted to build a sensor that does that, a real-time 3D sensing. So we start with color and depth processing plus motion sensing. So on the same sensor device, we put a color camera, we put a depth sensor, and I'm going to show more about that. And in some modules, we also put a motion sensor for applications I'm going to talk about. And that enables us to do real-time dense 3D reconstruction of the world like we do in our normal lives all the time. We don't even recognize that. And then we can build understanding capabilities on top. What is it that we see as we constantly move around? So let me show you the product under the hood. Often we get excited with the experiences that we'd like to deliver to the end user. So let's take a look at the basic technology that's often inside the hood to make that happen. So we put a lot of effort in building these sensor devices, making them so small that they could be put into the smallest devices, to flying drones, to your headsets in a VR device. So I'm going to show you a couple of sensors here. The first one that you see up on the top is our coded light RealSense technology. We model that to be SR300. It's got the world's smallest laser and MEMS projector combination within a 4 millimeter thick form factor. And we can create binary patterns in space, so we can flip those mirrors at 10,000 frames per second. And we have a high-resolution IR camera to take pictures of those. We can triangulate and assign a digital code for every point in space. So we can actually use the color camera to texture map and make the machine see and understand the world like we humans do. I'm going to jump to this third device that I'm showing here on the bottom. And that's inspired by human visual system. You got a laser projector to create patterns, but two infrared cameras that take pictures like the two human visual sensors. And then we have a processor on it that does the hardware acceleration of binocular disparity calculation for very low power and high speed 3D reconstruction. It also has a motion sensor built in for positional tracking. So that's only the hardware. We have put a lot of effort in building software to develop the understanding part of it. We'd like to recognize what you're doing with your hands as you are virtually manipulating content. We would like the machines to recognize you. For example, you might want to log into your PC without having to put your password in. Or you might want the robot to understand your emotions. Full body tracking, video conferencing with background segmentation, 3D scanning, I'll have more to say about that. And leading to the world of complete understanding of objects and their special locations in real time. So with that, let me just quickly show you a few application areas that we've built with this device. We've shipped millions of them since we have introduced them in the market. And literally, they're just amazing because they transform the devices that are already shipping today that you're used to using. But when you enable them with real-time visual and motion tracking information, you just transform them. And I'm going to show you some examples of products that are already shipping today, starting with the 3D sensing computing devices. We have had millions of laptops, tablets, 3D handheld scanner devices, and recently introduced Razer Stargazer peripheral device. They're all for 3D scanning. Out of many applications, let me just show you something about 3D scanning. How many of you have seen this news article in Time magazine? Barack Obama was invited at Smithsonian Institute to be the first sitting US president to be scanned into 3D. And the privilege was with the researchers at University of Southern California to create the digital 3D avatar for the president. You can see handheld scanners and photogrammetric techniques. And there you have Barack Obama in 3D. It was sent to White House so he could appreciate himself. So why am I showing you this? Because I'm going to now next show you another model, and might look familiar to you, actually wore the same suit. Could you please play this video? And it's a complete 3D reconstructed model, color texture mapped, not a picture. Could you please help me play this video? Thank you. So you can see as I'm being dragged around. So what's special about that was I was simply standing in front of my cubicle at Intel, and one of the engineers took a mobile device with RealSense camera built right in to create a 3D reconstructed model. So you could bring what was once available to the US president to people, common people like us, the experiences. In the interest of time, I'm going to move forward. There are many other examples of computing devices, but let me go into one that we believe are going to transform the society. And that's the new wave of autonomous machines, the robots and drones with real-time 3D sensing and understanding capability. Robots have already taken over and made our lives easy in the production lines, from Intel Fab to Tesla automotive manufacturing. But we are now starting to see a new wave of robots that can interact with humans and make our life better. I'm showing you some examples of products that are shipping now, and they all have RealSense cameras inside. The Saviok hotel butler robot, the Segway robot we showed at CES. We all love Segways to ride to the park, but what if I just want to take a little bit of a walk? I would like the robot to follow me around rather than me having to drag it around. We also introduced the Asus Zenbo personal home robot that interacts with you, it talks to you, it looks after your house. And obviously the drone. Anybody flies drones? We can take the pain of controllers from your hand. The drones can automatically fly and avoid colliding into trees and houses and people. So I'll just pick one or two examples out of many. Saviok Hotel Butler, if you have the opportunity to come to Cupertino, stay at the Aloft Hotel or the Crown Plaza in Milpitas, don't be surprised if you order something from the front desk and the hotel butler robot shows up to deliver this to you, right, in the middle of the night. Amazing, it's just a glimpse of the future that is to come. Next example is Unique Typhoon H, a drone shipping with RealSense. Could you please play the video on the right? Could you please play the video for me? Thank you. So you can see the drones able to fly around intelligently, reconstruct the world in real time, and navigate its path by itself. Drones are going to be really good for the society, as you know, from the delivery of goods to delivering life-saving material to disaster-stricken areas, and you need autonomous and intelligent drones for that. Okay, and we're all excited about virtual reality and augmented reality, especially after the introduction of really exciting products that are in the market now. And we have just recently unveiled our Project Alloy, and I'd like to tell you a little bit about that. And I'm actually borrowing from my good friend Michael Abrash on this. We ask ourselves the question that Morpheus asked in Matrix. You guys watched Matrix? Most of you have. So, you know, looking back in 1999, the question he asked is, so what is real? He goes on, how do you define real? And actually gives the definition. If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, taste, and see, then real really is just the electrical signals that are zipping around in your cortex. So the challenge for us engineers then is to, you have something on the laptop there. The challenge for us engineers is to create the sensations in your cortex that makes you feel as if you're in real life. The PC, can you please remove the text from there? Could you please remove the text from the bottom? Okay, thank you. All right, so Project Alloy, we focused it on the virtual reality experience to be untethered and all in one. So you don't have to be tethered or connected to the PC, you could really freely move around. And we have also added RealSense technology for inside-out 6 degrees of freedom tracking. So you don't have to rely on a setup that limits you to a small space for tracking. Humans do not require external sensors for us to track. I know precisely where I am as I'm moving around, as I flew in from San Jose, found the space here, I'm walking around here. I can use my sensors for real-time visual feature extraction and combining that with other sensors I have to not only reconstruct the world, but precisely locate my position there and track it. So we have attempted to do that with RealSense. We've also added hand interaction. The controllers are great for gaming, but in some cases you simply want to reach out, you want to see your hand, and you want to be able to interact with objects. So this is what is under the hood for Project Alloy. You have a really powerful application processor, a PC class processor. We have added a specially developed RealSense module for tracking. We have a sensor coprocessor for really low power, real-time performance for tracking and hand interactions and stuff. And in the interest of time, I'm going to just show you one demo out of this. Could you please help play the top right video, please? You're simply going to lift your hand in the virtual space, and there you go, you see your hands. And I am using the hand now to sculpt a virtual lathe. I can pick up anything and use that as a tool. When you have such natural interactive experience, it just feels amazing. You can merge the virtual and the real together with Project Alloy and many other developments that are happening in the industry with this. Couple of quick other mentions. It's not just with the robots, drones, and virtual reality devices and PCs and computers, but how about visually intelligent mirrors? Would you not like to just stand in front of the mirror and virtually change your clothes to see which one you like? Well, there are products that are already shipping. I'm showing you on the left Memomi's memory mirror. You can see that this gentleman is wearing a red color cloth, but he's able to change that digitally to see how it looks in another piece of cloth. I'm going to skip the Naked Labs video. They're a really exciting product. They're able to create a real-time 3D scan of your body to do fitting and track your health information to tell you how you need to manage your exercises and stuff like that. I'm going to skip it because I'd like to take 10 seconds to show you the future. I've so far talked about and showed you the products that are already shipping in millions of units, but we're really excited about the product that we're about to put into your hands. And that's our next generation RealSense camera that works from really close range for tracking purposes to really long range. And I brought a rough video that we recently captured when we took this next generation RealSense camera and took it for a drive. What are you going to see on the left is the color picture. What you'll see on the right is the pseudo color coded depth map. So if you just look at the scale here, it goes from centimeters to, I topped it out at about 60 meters or so, but you can go much further than that. Could you please just click next? In fact, I just did that. So you can see as I take this to a drive, you're seeing the real-time depth per pixel, really high-resolution depth map in outdoor driving conditions. And I'm not going to announce applications of this yet, because we often do that with our partners. You can imagine what it might enable. So with that, I'd like to extend my invitation to all of us to collaborate. We thrive in an open, collaborative environment. We really built a platform that you can build on, whether you're a researcher that would like to use real-time 3D sensing, or a product development engineer, a company that would like to partner with us to make your products shine and bring it to market. Please contact us. A lot of information on the website for downloading the SDK, ordering developer kits, and simply just reach out to us. That's my email address. Thank you very much.
I didn't see anybody in front of the microphone, which means no questions, Haijin. Thank you so much, Haijin. You have a question? So, please make yourself in front of the microphone. And until Haijin can give you a Jones, can send the microphones to your hand.
Not too far from now.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Paul Yippen from University of Missouri, and I have two questions. So first is, you didn't show, it was a very, great talk.
Thank you.
How about augmented reality? Why did you skip that? And related to that is, it's a crowded space. There's all the way from Google Cardboard to HoloLens, and you have some interesting markets, so what are some future directions? And then I'll ask the second question.
Great question. So the only reason I skipped it is because of the time. I was asked to finish up by 15 minutes. We have some really great projects on augmented reality. One picture that I showed there was actually a shipping product from a company called Duckree. an industrial augmented reality helmet for augmentation in industrial applications. And we have partnership with all of the companies that you mentioned right now. We're really excited about augmented reality.
And then the second question was, so for the Camera 400, what's the technology? It's not structured light, so is it LiDAR? Is it a 4mm LiDAR that we're gonna see?
It's a very good question you ask. We actually have not quite made an announcement on the specifics, but when we started working on this, this is not really just take a technology that exists and miniaturize it. We had to mix and match a lot of different technologies. It includes laser projectors and a combination of projected images plus stereo processing and the hardware accelerated algorithms for 3D reconstruction.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ajay.
I have a question.
So let's move to our next speaker. Yeah, our next speaker, Bill. Actually, I don't know many people in signal processing area, you know, familiar with Bill, but Bill actually is a legend if in the graphical area and also multimedia area. He is a senior vice president, the chief scientist at NVIDIA. He is also an entrepreneur scholar. Okay, he co-founded a company called Vilio, which is acquired in 2003 by LSI. He is also co-founded another company, actually, streaming processor, SPI, actually, which is actually built the foundation for the current GPU system. So he's a professor, chair professor of the Stanford University. He's a member of the National Academy of Engineering. He's a fellow of ACM, IEEE, AAS. He's a recipient of a lot of IEEE and ACM award. I barely can fit his description bio into one page, but let's welcome Bill to tell you about the GPU computing. Thank you.
Thank you. To be here. We've heard about virtual reality, we've heard about 3D depth sensors. I'm going to talk about something a little bit broader, something which actually touches many different application areas, including all those you've heard about, which is GPU computing. And we actually need to be celebrating a birthday, because it's the 10th birthday of GPU computing in CUDA. It was launched in 2006, but as you see from this timeline, the history actually goes back a lot further, almost 20 years, to the roots of stream processing at Stanford. And then once we sort of commercialized the technology in 2006 and launched it supercomputing, things moved very quickly, where now GPU technology is the enabling thing. It's powering the fastest supercomputers in the US and in Europe. We expect to have faster computers next year. It's the key ingredient that's really fueled the current revolution in deep learning. It turns out most of the technologies for deep learning, convolutional neural networks, backpropagation, all of that were around in the 1980s, but it didn't take off. And it didn't take off because people didn't have adequate computing power. It took until GPUs were available to do the training of these networks to enable that. And now it's being used to fuel that in image processing and speech and in many other areas. But let me go back and talk a little bit about the history. So in 1997, I started a project to build a programmable graphics processor called Imagine, and then a couple years later, we started a follow-on project to build a streaming supercomputer called Merrimack. And a lot of interesting technologies came out of this. Many of them had to do with programming. And in particular, one graduate student, who's actually the last author on this paper, Ian Buck, was developing the programming systems for this. We started with a language called StreamC, and that evolved into a language called Brook. And one thing we discovered is that we didn't have to wait till we built our specialized stream processors. GPUs were actually pretty close to stream processors. And so if we could modify them a little bit, we could run Brook on the GPUs. And in fact, this paper was in Transactions on Graphics in 2004. That same year, Ian, this is a picture of him in 2003. I'll show a picture of him today later. Ian ported Brook to GPUs, graduated with his PhD from Stanford, and went to work from NVIDIA with this gentleman, who's John Nichols. And actually, a little bit before that, in 2003, John had hired me as a consultant for NVIDIA, and I'd worked with them on putting some modifications into what became the G80, it was called the NV50 at the time, to support GPU computing. And so in 2006, when John, after having worked with Ian, launched CUDA, It really was sort of the culmination of a number of things. They had taken Brook, they had taken CG, the shading language used for graphics, and they went out and talked to a lot of customers, and what the customers told them is, we don't want a new language, we want C. So they gave the customers what they wanted. CUDA is C with some directives to create CTAs, thread arrays that work cooperatively using shared memory. And so we had the architecture, which had shared memory to allow these thread arrays to communicate efficiently. We had the language, and we had the processor to run it. And things really kind of took off from there. And the first area that really took off was science. When Titan, which is this figure, was first brought up, it was the fastest supercomputer in the world. It remains the fastest supercomputer in the U.S., and its sort of sister machine, PISDANT, at the Swiss Computing Center in Zurich, is the fastest supercomputer in Europe. They're both based on previous generation GPU technology, the Kepler technology, and this machine is 30 petaflops, which is a significant amount of computing horsepower. And so we're going to go beyond this next year using our Volta processors in collaboration with IBM. We're going to be building the Summit and Sierra supercomputers. They're going to be 10 times as powerful, up to 300 petaflops performance. 40 teraflops per node, and we fully expect these machines, when they're stood up, to be the fastest supercomputers in the world. Well, what does this mean? What it means is a lot of key problems that are important to society today are being solved that couldn't be solved otherwise. From simulating the Earth's climate so we can understand better the effects of increasing greenhouse gases on climate change, to simulating improved combustion, that's at the upper right, so we can build more efficient engines to try to reduce climate change, to simulating the colliding of galaxies at the bottom left, and to a lot of things having to do with simulating biology and understanding the workings of the human body, including recently a 3D reconstruction of the human genome, which turns out it's important to understand not just what the sequence is, but what the 3D structure is, that it, how things interact with the proteins that regulate and express genes requires that degree of fidelity. More recently, GPU computing has really enabled deep learning. If you look at the key technologies here, convolutional neural networks have been around since the 1980s. Jan LeCun had a classic paper in 89 on them. Backpropagation is actually even older than that. All of the training techniques have been around. And they were really missing two key ingredients in the 1980s. They didn't have adequate data to train these networks. You overfit a network if you train it with too small a data set. But more importantly, they didn't have the computing horsepower to do it. They got the data probably around 2000 to 2005. A lot of the big data center companies had sufficient data to train large neural networks. But until they had GPUs, they were unable to get that missing ingredient, which was sufficient power to actually train a network in a reasonable amount of time. And today, even with arrays of up to hundreds of GPUs, it still takes a couple weeks to train a state-of-the-art network. So it gives you an idea of that something you simply couldn't do with CPUs. It was actually a heroic effort at Google, where they used 16,000 CPUs to train a network that discovered cats. You may remember reading about that in the newspaper. We then worked with the people at Stanford, Andrew Ng, who's part of that project, and we repeated that project on 12 GPUs so that we were able to sort of democratize neural networks, bring it to people who didn't have the resources to have 16,000 GPUs. And it's really as if somebody has taken a spark to a tinder dry forest. Deep learning has really exploded like a wildfire in many applications. This graph is from a talk that Jeff Dean gave on the number of new projects at Google over time that use deep learning. And you see it's in the thousands now, and everything from Google Talk, if you talk to your phone and you think it works better than before, you can thank GPU computing, because it's training the networks on GPUs that enables that speech recognizer to be that good. To drug discovery, to image understanding, making maps better. Across the board, deep learning is the answer to many problems, and it's disruptive to numerous fields. People who spent careers developing manual feature detectors for both vision and speech wind up not being able to compete with networks that are trained on large amounts of data. From internet applications to medicine and biology, neural networks are now better than human at looking at various types of radiography and diagnosing disease, including looking at mammograms and giving diagnoses. They beat human experts at that. Video captioning for movies and still images, security and defense applications. It turns out today there are surveillance cameras all over the place, but they're typically used after the fact to figure out what went wrong, because you can't afford to hire enough people to watch all the screens. With deep learning, you can have a AI sitting behind each one of those screens, analyzing the images in real time, and use all of those surveillance cameras to spot things and stop them before they happen, rather than simply be used for postmortems. And one thing that for us at NVIDIA is particularly exciting is using deep learning for autonomous machines, and in particular self-driving cars. We have a product, DrivePX, and DriveWorks, the software that runs on it, that basically is the engine behind many different manufacturers' self-driving cars. Deep learning powered by GPUs is now superhuman at many tasks, from speech recognition, the understanding and comprehension of recognition programs like Baidu Deep Speech 2 and Google Talk is better than human. Image classification, the winners of the ImageNet competition have beat human a couple years ago. Face recognition, playing Atari games, and most recently beating the world champion at Go. AlphaGo was trained on GPUs using CUDA. Now, what's really great is CUDA just keeps getting better. We've just announced CUDA 8. It has a bunch of neat features in it. Unified memory is probably one of the biggest ones. You no longer have to separately declare whether your arrays are in host or device memory, basically in GPU or CPU memory. That you basically just declare arrays, and the software automatically puts them where they're needed. We've got better tools, libraries to support emerging applications like graph analytics and deep learning. And what's really exciting is we recently announced our Pascal GP100 GPU, which both has a tremendous amount of computing performance. It's 10 teraflops of 32-bit floating point. But actually, for deep learning applications, what's more important is that its 16-bit floating point performance is twice that, 20 teraflops, and its integer 8 performance is twice again that. To complement that high arithmetic performance, it has 750 gigabytes per second of memory bandwidth to HBM memory that's stacked on the GPUs. I don't know if there's a pointer on this or not, but those are the stacks above and below the GPU chip. They're actually all sitting on one silicon interposer, so we can communicate very quickly at low energy by putting those memories right next to the GPU on the same silicon under foundation. And then the other technology on GP100, which is really exciting, is a technology called NVLink. Instead of trying to interact with the rest of the world through a skinny 12 gigabyte per second PCI Express pipe, we have 160 gigabytes per second of bandwidth off the GPU that can be used to connect up to processors. The IBM Power8 has an NVLink on it, so you can basically access all of the Power8's memory at full memory bandwidth through NVLink. You don't have any throttling over PCI Express. And you can build systems like DGX-1, our deep learning supercomputer, which is 8 P100s together that basically act like one single 170 teraflop GPU. There wasn't that many years ago 170 teraflops would have been the fastest computer in the world. Now this is an appliance that many academics have in their research lab. But those 8 GP100s are connected together by NVLink, so they can read and write each other's memory, and you can write one program that runs on the whole thing without having to spend an enormous amount of time chopping your program up and manually structuring communications with MPI to tie it together. So let me wrap up here. I think I'm getting close to the end of my 15 minutes. When you vote, I hope you'll vote for CUDA and GPU computing. Because it really has been an enabling technology that underlies many of these other areas, whether it's virtual reality or whether it's depth sensing or whether it's Netflix recommending things to you. Those are based on deep learning for the recommender networks, which are trained on GPUs. CUDA has an interesting history, and to me as a former academic, I guess, it's an exciting one where we basically did fundamental research at Stanford with Ian Buck developing the Brook language and then going to NVIDIA and taking those learnings and evolving them into CUDA, a language that actually solved some of the fundamental problems that were remaining and really created GPU computing as we know it today. And since we launched it in 2006, it's really revolutionized scientific computing. People do not build large supercomputers today without acceleration, and NVIDIA GPUs are the most popular form of acceleration in those supercomputers powered by CUDA. The majority of HPC apps now are CUDA accelerated, and it's really taken off in enabling things like better understanding of our climate, better understanding of disease, better understanding of the natural world around us. GPU computing and CUDA were the key ingredient, the missing ingredient, that fueled the current revolution in deep learning. The algorithms were around, the large data sets were around. The technology that didn't take off in the 1980s, though, took off in the 2010s because the missing ingredient of high-performance GPUs was added that allowed people to train meaningful-sized networks in reasonable amounts of time, reasonable amounts of time being a couple weeks. Before that, it was simply infeasible unless you had access to tens of thousands of CPUs to train large networks. And today, all of the major deep learning platforms, TensorFlow, Torch, Theano, Caffe, are GPU accelerated for both single GPU and multi-GPU. And the people who are the state of the art here are using hundreds of GPUs to train single networks because it allows them to build larger networks to train on larger data sets, which gives them more accuracy and is what feeds that superhuman performance. And because this is an image processing conference, I'll point out that it's enabling image processing both via deep learning, which is how a lot of image processing is done today, but also we have a lot of projects where we're using classic computer vision techniques, SIFT and HOG and optical flow, and the libraries that run on GPUs are the state-of-the-art way of getting those done. So vote CUDA. Any questions? Like we have at least one.
I didn't see any people. Oh, he's here.
Yes,
I thought people are voting for you. That's they're busy.
Very, very short question. All the work of CUDA and everything sounds very interesting. But since the award is about visual innovation, what are the algorithms or the sensors or the contributions of NVIDIA in this domain? Because it is not clear to me.
Oh, that's a good question. So. I don't know who did the nomination for CUDA or why CUDA was selected over other things that NVIDIA has done, but NVIDIA certainly also has many contributions in the visual algorithms and in the techniques more applied. I think what's exciting about CUDA is it's the underlying foundational technology that feeds all of that and many other things as well.
Okay. Thank you so much, Bill.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Let's move on to the next speaker. Our next speaker is John, the Vice President of YouTube of Google. I tell you a secret, actually. Of the seven speakers, I like John's position better. I like his job better. The reason is I want his job. The reason is I have a daughter, 4 years old, okay. Since he was 2 years old, he started to grab my phones from me all the time. When he opened up the phone, the first app she was using, always YouTube, always, every time. So that's why I'm very jealous of John. You know, I cannot brag to my daughter that I have a better job. So John, basically, he is leading the new product development inside of YouTube, for example, gaming, kids, living rooms, music, and so on. He was also part of the success of Microsoft's early success of IE and Xbox. Today, he will come here to show you the promise of YouTube. Let's welcome John. Thank you.
Thank you. Since we're going to talk about YouTube, we kind of need to start with a video. Can we get the sound, please?
It started 10 years ago with a simple statement. Broadcast yourself.
All right, so here we are, one of the elephants.
And what happened next? Well, a door to a new world was opened.
Johnny, that really hurt!
A world where people began to share their personal moments.
Yeah, it's a long time, MC.
Hello, everybody.
Giving birth to a new generation of entertainers.
Justin Bieber's getting ready to go down.
See, this is YouTube. The place where you can express your spirit.
I think we all need a pep talk.
Tell your story for the world to hear it. I mean, think about it. On what other platform are dreams born? Normal people transform, sharing laughs. With the power to talk back, interact.
Hello, ladies. Look at your man. Now back to me.
Pay attention. This, my friends, is the reinvention of television. We've seen so many impeccable moments and epic feats.
I'm gonna kill you.
Proving that when we come together, we human beings can do some pretty incredible things. And even when the world faces tragedy, we come together as family like a symphony does, musically, beautifully, in unity, proving that yes, we can make a difference. This platform has given us the freedom to answer the ring of global conversations, putting them right in your face, seeing events through the eyes of people millions of miles away, spreading awareness, igniting passion and compassion, action and proaction, giving a voice to the voiceless. So much has happened in these 10 years, and we're not even done.
It is time to take action.
The best is surely yet to come. So
I love that video. It shows you the breadth of what we have on YouTube, but it also makes my job very hard because video is such a great way of communicating, and I can't really stand up to a video like that. But what I do want to say is, you know, I believe the greatest visual innovation of the digital age happened at the zoo. In 2005, two friends from PayPal stood by the elephant pen at the San Francisco Zoo and filmed the very first video that would appear on their new website. That video was shot on a camcorder, and the quality wasn't very good. But once that video was uploaded on their new site called YouTube, entertainment would never be the same. All of a sudden, a dynamic that had existed from the dawn of the film camera had changed. And now anyone in the world could broadcast a video to everyone in the entire world. You didn't have to pitch anything to a network executive or studio producer. You didn't have to go on casting calls. You didn't need to get satellite time to beam a signal into somebody's house, and you didn't need to raise funding. With YouTube, you suddenly had access to an instant and global distribution network. And over just one decade, that revolution has had far-ranging implications throughout media, altering ideas of what entertainment is. It has unleashed unique and entirely new and staggeringly popular forms of content. From beauty vlogging, to educational videos, to unboxing. Still don't quite get unboxing, but my kids love it. It's shrunk our world, allowing us to experience culture from countries that had previously been hidden behind remote borders. And it's given millions of people the opportunity to explore content based on their own individual interests, rather than being satisfied with entertainment that was manufactured for the masses. And that freedom also changes the rules of the industries that have been built to entertain and inform us. It has changed the way that we watch the news, empowering citizen journalism from Ferguson to Syria, enabling them to share their plight with the world. It's elevated advertising into an art form, turning commercials into must-see clips. And it has resuscitated the music video, bringing a beautiful visual dimension to our favorite music. Today, over 1 billion people turn to YouTube every single month to watch the world's largest library of video. They watch whatever they want, whenever they want, on whatever device they want, up to hundreds of millions of hours every day. And they share those videos too, at a rate of 400 hours of video uploaded every minute. But all of this happened not just because some people started a video uploading site. It's happened because throughout YouTube's nearly 11 years, we've developed a lot of technical innovations that have allowed us to build that platform. For example, digesting those 400 hours of video that get uploaded every minute is not easy. To make sure each user can broadcast themselves, we've spent years building systems that can crack and faithfully extract the video and audio data inside all of the diversity of video files that we get uploaded. A little personal note here, the early days, I was responsible for making AV Sync work on H.264 when we started rolling that out. And I'm sure those of you that have worked in this space can understand the unique form of madness that comes from troubleshooting AV sync issues, watching that same clip over and over again, looking for that 100 millisecond gap. So needless to say, there's a lot of different standards for the various components in media files, and we try to deal with all of them. That's part of what makes our job so challenging. We need to correctly decode it, despite the variety, despite the frequent errors, missing components, and everything else that happens with media. Not only that, we're consistently adapting to new video files that are larger, sharper, and richer. This chart shows the resolution of videos that are uploaded to YouTube on a monthly basis over the last several years, with the smaller resolutions up at the top, working all the way down to 1080p at the bottom. One thing that stands out is that 10% of green up at the top is actually non-standard video whatsoever. There's a whole crazy collection of videos in there, and it's been steady, about 10%. It just shows you the diversity of what we deal with. But what you can also see, especially over the last couple of years, is the dominance of 720p and 1080p. 5 years ago, 480p, that blue bar in the middle, was almost everything, and now its days are clearly over. This chart shows the rapid adoption of 4K uploads, which is still a little too small to see on that previous chart. But you can see how rapidly it's accelerated over the last couple of years. Although obviously it's relatively small as a percentage of everything that gets uploaded to YouTube, this is still a pretty significant fraction. The thing that I find most interesting is you can see that we started getting a lot of 4K video uploaded well before 4K TVs and displays had become mainstream. We actually supported 4K and even 8K video back in 2010. And what I love about this is we're able to break the chicken and egg problem that often hinders adoption of new technologies. As creators wait for distribution channels to support something and those distribution channels wait for content, we just forge ahead. We make these available, and our creators are always pushing the boundaries and taking advantage of our ability to distribute that content. So we did this with 4K and 8K. We're doing this now with high frame rate video, high dynamic range video, and VR video. To keep up with that constant increase in video resolution and quality, we've invested a lot in advancing the state of the art in video compression. When YouTube first launched in 2005, everything we encoded was in H.263 at a maximum resolution of 320 by 240. If you were to actually try and serve 720p video with H.263, we'd need about 4 megabits. As H.264 gained widespread adoption, especially through mobile devices, we re-encoded the entire catalog of YouTube videos to H.264 for better quality and smaller file sizes. And you can see that gets you a 720p video at about 2 megabits per second. And then in 2010, we bought Onto Technologies, and we made their VP8 codec freely available to further advance video compression and in the industry. And today, much of the video we serve is in VP9, where we can serve even better quality 720p with just 1 megabit per second. That brings higher quality video, not just for us with great internet connections, but it's critical for increasing access and saving money for the next billion users who are just coming online and are often on slow, expensive cellular networks. This shows you the impact of VP9 on those congested networks by showing how many playbacks would have been 240p or below, and with the enablement of VP9, we're now 360p or above. Reaching as high as 50% in some countries. So we've been able to bring all these great improvements, not just to new videos that get uploaded after we launch them, but to every video that was ever uploaded to YouTube. And we could do this because we didn't just transcode those original videos in the early days to that 240p, H.263, and throw the original away. We kept the originals so that every time we introduce a new technology, we can go back to the source and reprocess the original material, which is how Charlie here went from 240p up to 480p. And that's why the videos you uploaded back then probably look better today than they did when you first uploaded them. These advancements don't come for free. They take a tremendous amount of computational power. I'll take some of the machines that Bill was talking about. And our creators are not only just uploading those higher resolution videos, they're uploading longer videos as well. And so we have a huge amount of video to process. So whenever a video is uploaded, we immediately start transcoding multiple different versions of it in different resolutions, different formats, so that we have something that is ready for any resolution, any screen, any network, any platform. And in order to do that efficiently, we've built a massively parallel video processing engine that breaks those videos up into many small chunks so they can be processed independently and then reassembled. Now, obviously, there's risks with this. You could lead to a situation where those chunks are processed somewhat differently, and the result could be an inconsistent video file. But thanks to machine learning analysis that we've done on tens of thousands of videos, we've been able to optimize that process so that our encoders consistently create an incredibly high level of picture quality. And we've also built our own quality metrics so that we can really understand the quality of our output at scale. Remember those 400 hours of video that are being uploaded every minute. We calibrated these metrics with subjective tests to ensure that the human eye perceives them just the way that our metrics do. And then we use that quality evaluation to find problems before our viewers are able to see them. So we're still constantly pushing these boundaries. I talked before about 4K and 8K video, but we also, as I said, supporting high dynamic range video, high frame rate video, 360 degree video, and VR video. I'm excited to hear about Lytro. No matter what kind of video anyone out there is producing, our job is to make sure that billions of people can see it. One of the other changes that's happened is people have started using their smartphones to capture and share video rather than camcorders and sophisticated desktop video editing packages. And so what we've done is we've moved a lot of the video processing up to the cloud, enabling things like stabilization, color correction, and slow motion. But also when I talked about citizen journalism, we also need to do things like blurring and object tracking. We recently launched a custom blurring tool that allows you to blur things like faces, license plates, and other identifying information, which is critical for people taking videos of sensitive situations. Now, we've talked a lot about the technology, but one of the things that is amazing about YouTube is also how we've changed the business of video. We work to protect rights holders of content so that their content isn't misused. We built a system called Content ID, which automatically scans every video that's uploaded to YouTube against reference files that are supplied by creators. And when we detect a video that uses their content, we give them the ability to take the video down or leave it up and earn ad revenue from it. And that brings me to one of the really unique features about YouTube, which is that in 2012, we expanded our partner program to enable sharing of ad revenue with all creators, not just established media companies. And in YouTube's first decade, the scale of these payments, the ad revenue that we share with creators, has become massive. While some paychecks are larger than others, to date we've paid out billions of dollars to millions of content creators. That money goes to help the bottom line of traditional media companies and music labels. We've paid $3 billion to the music industry alone. It's helped anchor the growth of several new media properties, from BuzzFeed to Vice. And it's created an entire business-to-business layer of service firms that provide things like sophisticated data analysis, content rights management, and sophisticated ad technology. But most importantly, YouTube's decision to pay everyone has helped democratize what the job of content creator is. Every month, we deposit money into the accounts of millions of people around the world. And that money is what changes the act of making video from a hobby into a career for these people. It what gives them the idea that working in the media industry doesn't have to be an option just for the well-connected or the very lucky. Anyone can make a viable living on YouTube. Taken together, all these innovations, from the technical infrastructure to our thoughtful business models, have transformed media and entertainment into a truly free market where anyone can throw their hat in the ring. And while that's led to a share of cat videos, sure, it's also changed the way that students are taught in schools, the way we get our news, the way new talent is discovered, the way brands advertise to the public, the way music is discovered and enjoyed, and most importantly, the way that stories are told and who can tell them. And that's not too bad for something that started at the zoo. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Any questions? I didn't see anybody. Maybe they are very enjoying your beautiful YouTube video.
Thank you
so much, John. Let's move to the next speaker. Yeah. Our next speaker is Tim, the Vice President of Lycho. Tim has a very unique life. He spent his early career, 15 years, at contributing with very famous movies. You see a lot of names there: Toy Story, Monster, Finding Nemo, Cars. Some people wish being only part of one of them, but he has been with so many of them. Now he's coming here to tell you, you know, how to change the world with the life, with the light field technology. Let's welcome Tim. Thank you, Tim.
Thank you. You'll have to excuse me, everyone, while I plug in. All right, can we switch over to the MacBook on the stage, please? So before we get started, I can just get started here a little bit and talk a little bit about what I'm going to talk about. So I'm Tim. I'm VP of Engineering at a company called Lytro. Lytro is a company that's bringing light field technology to high-end film and media and VR production. For those of you who don't know about light field, I'm going to walk through a little bit about what light field is, and during the course of this talk, I'll talk about three big applications of light field technology, as well as how we actually capture and play back and process light field in a couple of different ways. Just a moment. It's always the technical difficulties. So I'm curious, for those of you in the audience, how many of you have heard of light field? Oh, wow, okay. All right, pretty educated audience. And how many of you feel like you have a pretty decent understanding about what light field is and what it can do? All right, great. Excellent. Absolutely. We're going to try to plug it in the back. Thanks. All right, looks like we're going. I don't think I have advancing capability on the remote, though. Is that me or you, Madison? Is that the guy? All right. All right, now we're in business. All right. So it sounds like a lot of you already know a little bit about what light field is, but I'm going to give a brief introduction just as a refresher course, and then some of what I'll talk about during the course of this talk is how we actually capture light fields at LITRO, and there's a couple of different mechanisms we use depending on the application. So first of all, what the light field is. The light field essentially is a volumetric capture of the scene. What we're capturing when we're capturing the light field is all of the rays of light that are entering a specific volume of space. Now that volume might be the body of a camera. If we're filming something for cinema. That volume might be for VR, something like a beach ball that's around your head so you can move around in a scene. But when we capture all of the rays of light that enter the volume, what we're capturing is not just their color and intensity, but also the direction that those rays of light came from. And that allows us to do some pretty sophisticated reconstruction of the scene in real time and with processing after the fact. So the light field, in essence, is capturing the natural flow of every ray of light throughout the entire scene. We capture it by leveraging either hundreds of individual cameras, in the case of VR, and I'll talk a little bit about that later, or millions of microscopic lenses, in the case of a panoptic camera that's based on a microlens array. This technique requires some really tightly coupled hardware and software in order to be able to do the processing of the data that we capture on set. But there are some really significant advantages. Most importantly, every pixel contains not just color and brightness information, but also the angular information of how the light ray entered the sensor, as well as depth properties of where that object was in space. That means that every camera decision we can make into a virtual decision after the fact. So some really basic properties that you think about being baked into how you captured the data in the first place actually can become computational properties of the data after the fact. And then every scene becomes a 3D model versus a 2D image. Now, at LITRO, we're big believers that this is going to cause an inevitable transition from thinking of video and thinking about image capture as a 2D phenomenon to something that's actually volumetric. That video will fundamentally become volumetric, and that this shift will eventually be more impactful than the shift from film to digital some years from now. So in order to drive that home, and in order to talk a little bit about what light field can do, I'm going to walk through three different use cases that light field enables that we're doing today at LITRO. And in the process of doing that, we'll talk through a couple of the different products that LITRO has in the market today. So first of all, light field virtualizes the physical camera, and this is most important for content creators that are working in the cinema space. Let me just give you two quick examples. So first of all is computational depth of field. So I'm going to play this shot. This is a shot from a film that we launched at NAB when we launched LITRO Cinema, our first cinematic camera. And I'm going to point out a couple of things about this shot. So first of all, when the boy comes up, you can see that the ball is in sharp tack focus, that baseball. But then over the course of the shot, as the boy turns screen left, the depth of focus actually racks backward. And so then the entire scene is in focus, whereas at the beginning of the shot, the boy is completely out of focus. Now, those of you who know anything about optics and cameras know that this is impossible to do. This would require changing at the same time exposure, shutter angle, possibly ISO, as well as rack focus. And it would just be not possible to do this with a normal camera. But this is something that we can absolutely do with light field. Just to highlight the difference here, on the left is where we start the shot with very, very shallow depth of field. That shallow of a depth of field is actually not possible optically. That is the moral equivalent of an f0.3 lens, which doesn't really exist. And then on the right is where we end the shot, where everything is in sharp focus. The way that we do this with light field is because we've captured all the angular data about how the rays are traveling in the scene, we can do this purely optically, computationally, after the fact, just with a click of a button. Another great example is computational frame rate and shutter angle. So these are two areas that are fundamental and core to how you think about your capturing video. You think about the frame rate that you're capturing very much early on, very frequently in pre-production. You think about the shutter angle as part of exposure. But with light field, we can compute these things after the fact and change them after the fact. This is a shot that we captured at 120 frames per second, but we can dynamically, after the shot has already been taken, we can change the shutter angle to be 180, 360, or even something impossible like 720, where conceptually, we're leaving the shutter angle open for twice the frame rate. And we get exactly the right, correct optical motion blur throughout all of that, almost as if it was a volumetric flow of the light rays through the scene. So how do we do all this? We do this with a camera that we launched at NAB in April called LITRO Cinema, which we really think of as a really ultimate creative tool for cinema and broadcast. The camera is large, as you can see here, and it has in it what we believe is the highest resolution, highest frame rate imaging sensor ever built for video. It captures at 755 raw megapixels at 300 frames per second. I look forward to when I can upload that to YouTube, John. It has, in addition to that, a built-in active depth sensing system to help augment the light field depth information as well. And all of that we need all of that resolution in order to capture all of the angular rays of light in the scene and then ultimately produce high-resolution film quality 2K or 4K renders. I want to talk a little bit about how this works, because I think that's some of the most interesting technology that Lytro has. So the cinema camera works with what we call a micro lens array. This is sometimes called a planoptic camera or an MLA. The micro lens array, as shown here, is a wafer scale piece of glass that's etched with microscopic lenses. In the case of cinema, when we say wafer scale, we mean as large as the sensor, which is half a meter wide, so it's actually a relatively large piece of glass. And it has millions of individual microscopic lenses. The way that the whole system functions is there is a main lens just like there would be with any camera. And the main lens focuses the light at the micro lens array. But instead of capturing just one pixel of information at each, what we would call a lens lid or at each micro lens, what the micro lens does is it then scatters the light from all of the incoming directions of that ray bundle. And then that's how we get different angular information about where the light is coming from through the main lens and then ultimately onto the image sensor, which is sitting just behind a micron or two behind the micro lens array. What we can do with that is really interesting. So obviously now we have all this angular information. That's how we compute depth of field, how we can change focus after the fact. But we can also compute different points of view within the main iris of the main lens. We call these sub-apertures, and of course, and the way to think about them is that there might be different images that are captured at different points within the main iris of the lens. Those different sub-apertures clearly have different points of view. And so one of the things we can do with the system is we can create truly correct stereoscopic with one set of capture without a beam splitter or anything like that, because we have two different viewpoints at different interocular distances within the scene. We can also do interesting reprojections of the scene from these different sub-apertures. This will be an important concept to remember when we talk about the VR camera, because it's a direct analogy there. So I want to dive now into light field for VR, AR, name your R, and talk a little bit about how light field helps us there. So remember that the light field volume is effectively capturing ray data from every angle entering some specific volume and doing that at a pretty high frame rate. What that means for VR is that we can now, within that viewing volume, we can generate any virtual view looking in any direction with any field of view. So what that allows us to do is really provide a unique breakthrough sense of presence and realism for live action VR. And to talk a little bit about what that means and what I mean by breakthrough sense of presence and realism, I'm going to show this quick chart that we put together, where we kind of think about VR and how immersed you are in VR in sort of two dimensions. So on one dimension is immersion, which is the big difference there is 3 degrees of freedom versus 6 degrees of freedom. In 360 video, for instance, you have 3 degrees of freedom. You can move your head side to side, up and down. But you can't move your head side to side, and you're not in the world. And when you do move your head side to side, what happens is the world moves with you. It's as if a video is playing on a 360 sphere around you. And so when you move side to side, the world moves with you rather than you moving with the world. The Oculus that Michael talked about at the beginning provides positional tracking, which allows you to move within the world instead of having to have the world move with you. That provides a lot more immersion, but it requires 6 degrees of freedom. So we track the position of your head as well as the rotation of your head. The other dimension on the horizontal axis here is what I'm referring to as realism. So think about the sort of fidelity of content that you might see in a Hollywood film, where you see live action capture or you may see visual effects quality computer graphics versus what you might see in a computer game, where the graphics are very, very impressive, but are rendering in just a few milliseconds instead of many hours, and so therefore have a little bit less fidelity, and they don't look quite as real. Today in the VR space, game engines are occupying low realism, high immersion content, and doing a very, very good job at it, and doing some pretty amazing things there. And 360 video is occupying low immersion, 3 degree of freedom content, but that's capturing the real world or showing us visual effects quality rendered content. But nothing yet has been able to do high immersion, 6 degrees of freedom, live-action content, or high-quality rendered content. And that's exactly what light field allows us to do. To put a fine point on exactly what that allows and how it immerses you in the world, There are a couple of things that 6 degrees of freedom really gives you. So first of all is parallax, and this is probably the most important thing, the ability to see behind objects. This is one of the most critical aspects of being immersed and feeling like you're actually there in VR, is being able to look around and feel that the world is actually reacting to that motion. Also, view-dependent illumination. So things like mirrors or specular highlights are very important. They're excellent cues about parallax and about being immersed in an environment. We lose those in 360 video. And then finally is what we're calling truly correct stereo. For those of you who know a little bit about 360 stereoscopic video, those videos are optimized for bandwidth requirements to be optimized so that you get true correct stereo when your head is level and when you're looking at the horizon line. But if you look up or if you tilt your head, then you won't get truly correct stereo and that illusion breaks down. What you're seeing playing here on the left or on the right is the first ever piece of live action 6 degrees of freedom content ever produced. We announced this about 3 weeks ago and produced this with the Litro Emerge system, which I'm going to talk a little bit about now. So the way we produce all that content and the way we get 6 degrees of freedom is with a system that we've called Litro Emerge. I want to dive in a little bit into how Litro Emerge, and to do that, I want to harken back to the sub-apertures that we talked about with the cinema camera. So you'll recall with the cinema camera, we could create, from the angular information that we had, sub-apertures, each of which had different points of view. Well, the truth is there are actually two ways of capturing a light field, one with a microlens array system where we capture the angular information of the light, but the other is that we could capture these sub-apertures directly with a multi-camera system. And that's exactly how Litro Emerge works. So instead of a microlens array, we use a multi-camera system, and you can think of each camera as capturing a sub-aperture. And from those sub-apertures, we can create the angular information and synthesize the entire light field. The reason you might choose a multi-camera system over a microlens array system is because of the view volume you might want. So in VR, because the most important thing is 6 degrees of freedom, we want a view volume that's about a meter wide. That's really difficult to build a single imaging sensor that's a meter wide with a single entrance pupil that would be that wide in 360. And so we use a multi-camera system there. In the cinema camera, we can have an entrance pupil that's much smaller, maybe only 100 millimeters. And then in that case, we can use a microlens array system. So as I mentioned, these systems are very, very tightly coupled in terms of the hardware that needs to be coupled to the processing software and ultimately in VR for playback. So capture is done, as I mentioned, with a multi-camera system, generally configurable. We like to say rigs are cheap. We'll build a new camera rig for a new use case, and the processing pipeline remains the same. There's a lot of processing that we need to do with a multi-camera system like Litro Emerge. We need to match the color very precisely across the different cameras. We need to do depth reconstruction as well. And then eventually, of course, we're going to play all of this content back at 90 frames per second with just a few milliseconds of render time. So we need to render it into a format that's amenable for that. Final use case that I want to walk through is scene reconstruction. And we've heard a lot about this topic today, and we know that it's a very, very important aspect of imaging in general. And we've glanced off of it so far talking about light field. But I want to talk about a couple of examples where we can do a really great job of scene reconstruction using light field data. So first of all, the 6 degree of freedom VR capture that I mentioned, this is just a screenshot of us exploring that in Nuke, which is a compositing package, if those of you don't know it. The sphere in the middle represents the viewing volume. That's the sphere within which you watch the experience, and you can move your head within that experience. And what you're seeing projected out is just one viewpoint of the scene as it's been reconstructed by the processing software. And of course, we can reconstruct any viewpoint within the volume, so this is a much tighter data set than you might actually have complete. But it demonstrates that there's a very accurate scene reconstruction down to pixel level granularity. And then finally, in the case of cinema, we also produce a virtual model of the scene. And that virtual model is rich enough and detailed enough to provide something that we call depth screen, which is effectively green screen without green screen. So this is an example, again, from the film Life that we produced and shot earlier this year. We just took that shot actually in a parking lot, wheeled the camera out into a parking lot, took the shot there, but we know enough about the scene and we construct enough about the scene that we can then segment the scene, not by chroma key, not using a green screen, but just simply by depth. And we can do that with an enormous amount of fidelity. You see a lot of detail in the woman's hair and in that net that's around her hat. This is the kind of thing that would actually be very difficult to do with green screen or with chroma key, certainly almost impossible with rotoscoping or some other manual approach. But we can do this very, very accurately using the Planoptic camera because we have a very accurate representation of the scene. So this all sounds really great, and you might be asking, well, what's the catch? Well, the catch is data. So the good news, or the bad news, rather, with light field is that it's an enormous amount of data. John was talking about 4K video being supported on YouTube. The size of the image sensor for the light field, the cinematic camera, is the moral equivalent of 40K rather than 4K. So in general, we are 100 or 1,000 times more data to capture a full light field volume with high fidelity than we would be for a regular high-end capture with a cinema system or VR system. The good news is that data continues to get cheaper and processing continues to get cheaper. This is plotted in log scale, so orders of magnitude cheaper every decade. And so we know that that's true. We know that that's even more true when we move to the cloud, where Litro does all of its processing, where those prices are driving down pretty quickly and the processing power is going up dramatically. So while data is a huge challenge for Lightfield, it's the biggest challenge in order to be able to process these large data sets, we believe now that Lightfield capture and editing and processing is now just barely within our reach to be able to do really high-end applications for. But just wait for the next 10 years. And then we believe that light field processing and light field capture will eventually be the way that all video is captured, and we can't wait to see what that looks like. Thank you. I think we have time for some questions.
Any questions? Thank you, Tim.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now let's move to the next speaker. Our next speaker is Anthony, the vice president of Netflix. So nowadays, there are many kind of devices in the world. We call it the Internet of the Things, right? But if a device claims they're entertainment device, for example, phones, TV, a game console, if they don't have Netflix on that, it cannot sell, right? So people use that to watch Netflix. So Anthony actually spent recently around 10 years at Netflix. He's in charge of to deploying this video streaming on top of all kinds of devices. And he is now working to build the new innovations like high dynamic range, ultra high definition videos into their Netflix customers. Let's welcome Anthony to talk about the background story of Netflix. Thank you.
Thank you. Entertainment and technology are continuing to transform each other as they have been doing for over 100 years. From radio to broadcast TV, broadcast TV to cable TV, and now to internet TV, with each of these bringing better experiences. With broadcast TV starting in the 1950s, you could watch video in your home, and that was a miracle at the time. But with broadcast TV, you had only a few networks, and so not much choice. Then came cable TV, where you had hundreds of networks to scroll through. But what consumers really wanted was to be able to choose when to watch. The VCR let them do that to some degree, recording films and TV shows to watch later. The DVR made the VCR a little less clunky. Both the VCR and the DVR were early versions to give people what they wanted, on-demand television. With the internet, we can finally give people what they've always wanted. We can now put consumers across the world in the driver's seat when it comes to when and where they want to watch. Internet TV allows us to redefine what's possible. Great stories at your fingertips, on your smart TV, on your phone, your tablet, and your laptop. You can start, pause, and resume watching whenever and wherever you feel like it. You can watch on any device you want. You don't have to sit through commercials or be at the mercy of an 8 p.m. tune-in time. You just click and watch. A simple yet revolutionary shift from corporate to consumer control. The Netflix service is personalized for you and every other member of your household. We offer movies and TV shows for every taste and every age. Shows that inform, that provoke, that engage, and that delight. We're just beginning to break down the barriers so the world's best storytellers can find their audiences all over the world. We're shooting a sports comedy in Mexico, a crime drama in Italy, and a dystopian film about bioengineering in Korea. The possibilities of building connections between cultures and people are endless and important. My name is Anthony Park. I'm a VP of engineering at Netflix. I started there in 2008, and I currently lead a team called the Streaming Client Technology Engineering Team, which is focused on bringing the Netflix application platform to all devices. We work on mobile and tablet devices. We work on smart TVs, PC and Mac, game consoles, Blu-ray players, set-top boxes. I have amazing engineering peers at Netflix that build things like user interface, design, content delivery, and our cloud-based platforms that power the Netflix service. I'm also a Phoenix area native. It's fun to be here in Phoenix again in my old stomping ground. And I graduated from ASU with my MBA and Master's of Engineering. I'm proud to see that ASU is one of the sponsors for this conference. Much of my presentation today is taken from a keynote that our CEO, Reed Hastings, gave at CES earlier this year, where we launched our global service. We're now in over 190 countries everywhere but China. And I'm here to talk to you today about how the internet is changing television and how we're at the start of a global revolution. In 2008, the year that I started working at Netflix, we launched our first set-top box integration on the Roku. This little box would let you stream TV in your home over the internet. It was amazing for its time. CE firms were just beginning to figure out how to integrate the internet into entertainment devices. Since then, Netflix has reached almost half of all US households, something that took the cable industry over 20 years to achieve. Globally, we're now in more than 80 million homes, and people watch Netflix all over the world on any internet-connected device. TuneIn has been replaced by personal choice. We live in an on-demand world, and there's no going back. You can see this change in the Netflix viewing stats. In 2015, people watched over 42 billion hours of Netflix, up from 29 billion hours the year before. Several factors have made this shift possible. The internet is getting faster and more reliable. Devices are getting smarter, cheaper, and more widely adopted. Internet speeds have been increasing steadily, with a global average up 40% since 2013. While some countries are making more progress than others, they've all realized that a robust internet is key to economic prosperity and a better quality of life. The internet allows us to constantly experiment and improve, to learn and get better. At Netflix, we're always testing what works for consumers to remove what frustrates them and provide an improving experience. Faster, smoother internet delivery, more intuitive choosing, and ubiquity across devices. These are the things that make Netflix better. Rapid innovation allows us to change the game when it comes to storytelling. Netflix was the first to put up all episodes at once, to give consumers complete control and to start the binge era. We were also the first to release stories across a global footprint, allowing members, whether in Argentina or Finland, to be able to enjoy the same great story at the exact same time. So let's break down what we're doing to make internet TV even better. Our talented engineers are constantly testing to compress more data through more advanced encoding. Our encoding team is always evaluating new codecs and techniques to improve the video quality we deliver to customers. These statistics were recently published by our encoding team, evaluating the performance of different codecs on our library of real-world content. In fact, Ann Aaron, the director of video algorithms at Netflix, whose team wrote this paper, is at the conference this week, presenting about cloud-based processing for high-quality media streaming. And Jan de Kock, also an author of this paper, is here at the conference this week as well. Ann's talk is tomorrow. You should check it out. Netflix was also one of the founding members of the Alliance for Open Media last year, and we're working within that group to develop a new codec called AV1 that is highly efficient, interoperable, open, and royalty-free. Our adaptive streaming team works on adjusting playback in real time based on available throughput to always deliver the highest possible video quality. The goal is to deliver data so fast and so well on any device in any broadband condition. This adaptive streaming is facilitated by our OpenConnect network, caching content worldwide wherever internet service providers request it. We do this for free because it helps ISPs manage the Netflix traffic requested by our common customers. This highly efficient and decentralized network delivers Netflix video to our members throughout the world and allows us to deliver over 125 million hours a day of entertainment across the world. For nearly a decade, we have collaborated closely with CE companies to create the best possible consumer experience. Apple, Samsung, LG, Microsoft, Sony, Google, Nintendo, Vizio, and Panasonic, just to name a few. We have helped these companies unlock the value of entertainment on demand. Netflix is ready to stream in millions of smart TVs, Blu-ray players, and game consoles the minute that customers bring them home from the store on over 1,000 different models. There are remote controls throughout the world that feature easy, instant access to Netflix with a simple, dedicated button. The Netflix UI is already available in 17 languages. In fact, last week we just launched Turkish and Polish. And content can be viewed with any mix of subtitle and voice languages, which can even be changed on the fly in the middle of a movie. Our app is available everywhere in the iOS and Android universe, and we're working with phone and cable companies around the world to allow customers to sign up and pay for Netflix with a single click. We want Netflix to work incredibly well, whether you're watching in the living room, at the gym, or at 30,000 feet on Virgin America. We want your video to start instantly and be at the highest possible resolution. We want you to be able to pick up right where you left off of your favorite series, no matter which device you're using or where you are. And we want what you see to be pleasing to the eye, whether you're on an iPhone, a Samsung tablet, or an LG smart TV. While continually improving the audio and video experience, we also seek to find the right movie or series to put in front of you at the right time. We do this through continuous learning, by understanding what each member watches, whether they leave after 10 minutes, or whether they come back to complete the series or not. Every year, we do hundreds of A/B tests to refine what we present to our members. We test different variations of the title art, the look for our user interface, and even new features like automatic post-play. And our members pick the winners, resulting in more viewing, more engagement, and more satisfaction. One day, we hope to get so good at suggestions that we can put the right movie or TV show in front of you for your mood when you turn on Netflix. We still have a ways to go, but each day we're getting better and better at delighting our members. The internet allows us to deliver amazing video and audio quality, and we're enabling our creative partners to make the most of that potential. 2 years ago, we introduced Netflix in Ultra HD 4K. Today, Netflix is the leading creator of 4K content, and Netflix original series and films are primarily being done in 4K. This year, we started rolling out high dynamic range, which makes colors brighter and truer, creating a visceral sensation that's pretty amazing. With HDR, you might wince as an airplane flies into frame and the sun glints off of its wing. With wide color gamut, you can finally see the true color of the London bus. We have over 1,000 engineers focusing on better content delivery, more intuitive UIs, and incredible picture and audio quality. They do this in the service of telling amazing stories throughout the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Anthony. So let's move to the next speaker.
Thank you.
Thank you. our last speaker, but not the least one. I remember he is the second person that I cannot finish his bio in one page because he has too many awards. Okay. So Jamie, the co-inventor of the Kinect, Microsoft. So he, as I mentioned, I cannot put all the awards that he had, although he is so young. He got awards from MIT, from PAMI, from IEEE, from CVPR, and so on. Today he will tell you the story about Kinect and the future of this technology. Let's welcome Jamie. Thank you.
Thanks, Al. Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. I'm going to be talking about Kinect. And first of all, a big thank you to the awards committee for selecting us to be in this final. It's a huge honor to be on stage with such other amazing technologies as we've just seen. And I'm here really representing the whole Kinect team, and in particular Alex Kipman, who is the father of both Kinect and of HoloLens. So let's start by winding back to think about what Kinect, the original product, was. Kinect was launched back in 2010, and you can see this little box down in the, down underneath the television there. That is the Kinect sensor. Now, Kinect was the first step in Microsoft's journey towards making computing more personal and more natural. And Kinect shipped with three really innovative features at the time. Face recognition, so you could walk up to your Xbox and it would log you into your profile automatically. Voice recognition, so you could speak to it and control your media playback with your voice. And the aspect that I was involved with, full body skeletal tracking, that allowed these kids here to jump around in front of their console without having to and have their motions control the motion of the avatars that you see on the screen there, and thereby the gameplay, without having to hold any controllers or wear any special markers or anything like that. So stepping back even further, a couple of years before then, to 2008, I had just started at Microsoft as a postdoc in Microsoft Research in Cambridge. And I got a call out of the blue from Alex Kipman's team in Redmond, who were developing what was codenamed Project Natal. And they described to me the task they wanted us to solve, that of taking an image of a person, here's just a cartoon illustration, and turning that into some low-dimensional skeletal representation that you can use to drive the gameplay experience. Now, this has been a task that had been in the academic field of computer vision for many, many years, and one that was always one of these problems that's sort of 5 to 10 years away from being practical. And so we were, you know, needless to say, rather skeptical about getting this out into a consumer product. And then they started to tell us some of the constraints that we had to work under. So first of all, it had to really work for anyone. It could just, you know, anyone of different body shapes and sizes, and no matter what pose you're doing, it should be able to track you. Second, we're not allowed to calibrate the user. It just has to sort of be magical, and you walk up and it just works. And you're not allowed to instrument the user. A big one was the compute restrictions. We had to fit into the existing Xbox 360 hardware, which is sort of 2005 era, and not only fit, but fit very comfortably to allow the games to have enough horsepower to run the beautiful graphics they wanted to run. And finally, we had to ship it in a very short timescale. And again, this was a problem that had been outstanding for a very long time. So needless to say, we were very skeptical, given this, that we could possibly do this. And really, the only thing that gave us some hope was this thing, the depth sensing camera that Kinect was going to ship with. And Kinect, as you may well know, uses a structure, the original Kinect uses a structured light technology where you'd shine out a pattern of dots in infrared through the laser emitter that's in the under that left arrow there. And then that would reflect off the scene back into an infrared camera, the right arrow there. Through some clever stereo processing, you're able to reconstruct depth in the scene. And what does this look like? Well, it looks something like this. This is a view of a depth image, point cloud of me holding out my hand in front of my body. It's been rotated to a virtual camera viewpoint slightly from the side. And so you can see that you really get a separation between the hand that's at the front, the upper body and my head in the middle, and the background wall in the background. And why did this get us excited? Well, it's because depth cameras really make computer vision a lot more practical. It makes it far easier to deploy these things in real user environments rather than just working in the laboratory. So in particular, they work in low light levels. You don't have to worry about ambient light so much. You can much more easily separate the foreground from the background. You don't have a problem of scale anymore because all of the readings that you get back from the camera give you values in millimeters. And finally, and very importantly, it sort of abstracts away the problem of dealing with different clothing color, hair color, skin color, because it just senses geometry. It doesn't worry about the actual appearance in the scene. So this sounded great to us. Of course, we were still having to worry about all sorts of other challenges that still remained. So the variety in pose, the variety in height and weight, the fact that people wear clothing, sometimes baggy, and the fact that the camera is always going to have a limited field of view, and so you may not see the whole person. And after much head-scratching, we came up with the following solution, which took us all the way to launch. And that was to not try and solve the problem directly, but to go through this intermediate step of labeling each pixel in your depth image as one of a number of different parts of the body, here color-coded in these different colors. And the idea was that if you could do this reliably for whatever pose the body gets into and whatever shape the user has, then combining this colored suit representation with the input 3D information from the depth camera gets us 90% of the way to having the full skeleton that we wanted. Now, to us all today, this may, in 2016, this may sound very obviously like a machine learning problem, a classification problem, a semantic segmentation problem. And to us in Microsoft Research back in 2008, that was also moderately clear. But to our partners in the product group, machine learning was, if anything, a blip on their radar. And so it took quite a lot of effort to persuade them that machine learning was something that they should bet on at the time. And part of proving that this machine learning would work was about getting good training data. And of course, this is training data is the key to the success of any machine learning task. Now, again, because the depth camera had abstracted away all of the stuff we'd have to worry about in terms of appearance, we could turn to fairly standard computer graphics techniques to render images of of the geometry that we're seeing in the scene, the image from the depth camera, paired with the segmentation images that you see here that we wanted to learn to predict. And so this video here just illustrates how the scale of the data and the variety in the training data that we were able to generate. And this essentially all came for free because we could just use computer graphics because we had these depth cameras to train. And so this image here illustrates the scale here as well. This was a million images that we were using to train. Each image, of course, contains thousands of pixels. And so at the time, this is one of the largest scale machine learning problems that was out there. And so we turned to, we put a lot of effort into just to training this thing up and just getting it to work. Today, it would be much simpler with our big beefy GPUs, but at the time, we invested a lot of effort into training this thing up in a distributed manner. Of course, once you've trained this up, the model that you get is extremely efficient to evaluate. And so we could deploy it under those extreme compute constraints that we had with the Xbox 360. And so doing all of this allowed us to get results that looked something like this. So on the top image, top left, you can see the images coming off the depth camera. The top right, you see these body parts that we're able to classify. Each image here is being treated independently. There's no temporal information being used here, which made it robust to loss of track. And then at the bottom, you can start to see the 3D understanding that we start to have of the user. And this is what drove the gameplay in Kinect. So as I say, Kinect launched in 2010. Somewhat to my surprise, did remarkably well. We even got a Guinness World Record for the fastest selling consumer electronics device. But I think Kinect's legacy will actually not be in the gaming sphere, despite this success. It will be more in the fact that it opened up a new ecosystem for doing research through open source SDKs, through the Kinect for Windows SDK, and later on through other depth cameras such as the RealSense. It has really opened up a huge wealth of applications that were just impractical or just very, very hard before. And just as a quick sanity check, if you go on Google Scholar and search for Kinect, there's 66,000 hits. I don't know what the breakdown of that is, but there's going to be a very, very large number of academic papers out there using Kinect today. And I'm just going to highlight a couple of quick examples of these from my lab in Cambridge. The first is a medical example. I'll just play this video and let it speak for itself.
The healthcare industry has got a lot of technology, and yet we feel that we're not making the best use of that technology and that data.
We saw a real possibility to use all of the expertise that we have in the building around machine learning, computer vision, to assess and diagnose the progression of multiple sclerosis. Multiple sclerosis is currently assessed by a neurologist using a clinical standardized rating scale. And this is where technology has a real strength.
The role of machine learning is to find an automated way to classify the patient's condition given a certain set of movements.
We're not trying to replace the neurologist or the nurse. What we're trying to do instead is to provide some data that's going to help the expert make a better assessment.
We worked with a team at Novartis Pharma AG who helped us understand what kinds of things are needed in clinical trials and how it is that we go about partnering with clinics.
What we've been able to do in this collaboration is work with university hospitals, Microsoft Research, as well as our own Novartis research teams to bring together the best talent needed to completely change the paradigm.
SSMS system provides a consistent quantified measure of motor ability over time. It's there to really help the doctor, to help the patient, to make the best decisions they can about their treatment.
So that's a great example of an application of Kinect in the sphere of healthcare. Another research project, completely unrelated, was this called Kinect Fusion, that was all about picking up the Kinect and walking around 3D environments and scanning them in. And by tracking the motion of the camera from one frame to the next and integrating and fusing out the noise in the depth cameras, we're able to get beautiful 3D reconstructions of environments such as you see here with this book, this bookstore. So coming back to the skeletal tracking work that I started with, I think it's interesting, while it was a great success in the gaming sphere, it's really interesting to reflect on why it hasn't become an alternative dominant user interface for computers. And I think there are many reasons for this, of course, but I think the most salient ones are these, that it was tracking the body at quite a coarse level, and your motions required a lot of effort. And you can't, of course, do those motions particularly fast. And so you ended up with a system that was great for jumping around and getting exercise in front of your Xbox 360, but it wasn't so great for day-to-day user interaction tasks. And so we went back to the drawing board and started to think about what else is there out there that you could use the same ideas, but really have a much broader application. And of course, the answer is our hands. Our hands are capable of very fine motion. It's extremely low effort. And we know through the fact that we can type or play piano or do sign language that we're able to communicate with very high bandwidth using our hands. So we rather naively decided straight after ConnectChip to look at hands, and we thought, okay, this will be easy. We'll be able to just take what we did for Kinect and apply it to hands, and everything would be fantastic. Unfortunately, with hindsight, it's very easy to see that we were being very naive, and that there are additional very tough challenges here, especially, I think, the challenge of self-occlusion, for example, when your hand is side onto the camera, and the fact that the hand is capable of rotating pretty freely about three different axes, whereas if you're standing in your living room playing Kinect, you're probably at most rotating about one axis and not doing cartwheels and handstands. And so it's taken us a little while, but I think we've now really cracked it. And this is a video I'll play of our SIGGRAPH, from our SIGGRAPH paper this year. And you'll see there's just a regular Kinect camera. We're about 2 to 3 meters away from the sensor in all of this. And we're able to track the motion of both hands in real time, very fine detail. One thing we were exploring with this paper was the applications of this technology, and in particular the idea of using a physics-based paradigm for interaction so that you can use all of the affordances that you know and love from the real world in the virtual world. So we saw sliders and dials and knobs here, keyboards and pianos. I'm not suggesting anyone goes out and plays a concerto on this, but it illustrates the point quite nicely. Here's an example of pointing. Of course, we could get very, very precise pointing and gestures to control things there. Here's an example of analog interaction, where the pitch and yaw and roll of your hand are being translated directly into the character on screen. This was a fun one where we were just doing virtual thumbstick controls to the same effect. Here's a two-handed example where we have one hand that brings up a palette. You can select tools and colors from it, and then you can draw things out with your right hand. And finally, a little game prototype just to put everything together. So you're trying to get your character to navigate safely through this world by knocking down blocks, throwing these rocks out of the way. There's a little Simon Says puzzle in a moment where you have to replicate the motion on screen of the hands, etc. And these were all prototypes just put together with a few interns over the summer last year, but really illustrate, I think, the potential for this technology. So I'm going to wrap up now and turning to something different, the Microsoft HoloLens. This is another of Alex Kipman's inventions after Kinect, the world's first fully untethered holographic computer, fully self-contained augmented mixed reality device, and super, super exciting. Not least perhaps because it has a depth camera in it. This is nothing less than a Kinect that has, we've shrunken it down over the years, managed to fit it into the HoloLens. And this is what's driving a lot of the unique experiences on HoloLens, the ability to map out the environment that you're operating in and use that to place holograms in sensible places, and the ability to sense the gestures of the user and use that to drive the UI. So I'm extremely excited about the future of HoloLens, you should all go and try it if you haven't yet. So I'm going to wrap up there, say thank you to the whole Kinect team. Alex Kipman here is the guy front and center in the middle. And thank you all for your attention. Please come and talk to me after the break. Thanks.
Thank you, Jamie. Now I would like to invite all the keynote speakers, for this session, come to on stage. The general chair, Lina, want to recognize all of you with the plaques, certificates, and so on. So I don't know what's order.
Remind the audience to vote. You see that paper? You think it's a drink ticket? It's not. You have a voting code. So go and go to 2016.IEEEICIP.org/vote. Cast your vote now, otherwise you'll forget later maybe. And the vote is closing in 1 hour. Okay? And second, we'd like to really thank the speakers for excellent keynotes. This was very motivational. We even have here high school students we invited. Also, we have Native American also students we invited to listen to your talk because I think what you did is very inspiring to the young generation. We want to show them what engineers and computer scientists can do in changing the world and impacting people's life. So thank you. For everything you did. It's impacting everybody's life. That's why it's so important. Thank you.
Missing etching. Etching cannot make it, yeah. This is not an award yet. It's just for keynote tonight for award.